All right, let's get the first vote up there. Ready, set, vote. All right, lots of colors, so talk this one over. All right, let's try and vote again. Ready, set, vote as pairs, go. Wow, that converged. All right, working magic. Let's go over them. So the closest to plan and document scheduling and monitoring are Agile points and velocity. Yep. Agile is using kind of retrospective. What's the experience of your team in assigning points and how fast you use them to predict the future? Yep. As opposed to in advance making the schedule. That's a big difference. The closest to the software requirement spec of plan and document is Agile user stories. Yes, those little tiny 3x5 cards are your written documentation of the specs that you work with the customer. And that's as opposed to a 100-page book or hundreds of pages book and an IEEE standard. Agile has no equivalent to ensuring requirements such as traceability. Yes, that's what the BDD is. BDD gets the requirements into user stories, and we'll see shortly that we can take those 3x5 cards and turn them into acceptance tests. So we're going directly from the customer, give them written cards, what the features we want, implement them iteratively, and that's the acceptance test. We make sure those features are there, where it's not part of plan and document, so they have these traceability tools to try and make sure you do that. And so actually 4 and 3 were false, but that would have been kind of clever. Okay, questions about this? Questions about that? Good. All right, so that's what this alternative universe looks like. So when you guys make these comments, oh, I know how software is really built. Okay, yeah, there's another way to build software. This isn't the only way. It's got positives, and you know, if I was doing space shuttle stuff, I'd probably use the plan and document with all that stuff, but not for a lot of things. Okay, so let's go ahead, and we'll have time to do one more segment about comments. So this is, again, another thing about writing beautiful code. And this is what's interesting. I have two of my good friends are Armando Fox and John Osterhout. John Osterhout used to be a faculty member here, one of the best programmers I've ever met. And he and Armando just do not agree about comments in general, right? Armando believes in self-documenting code, and Osterhout thinks that's evil. Self-documenting code is evil. So let me go over Osterhout's advice, and we'll talk a little bit about where they agree. Okay, so examples of bad comments, which they both agree on this. So here's a good, useful comment. Add one to I. Well, thanks. I'm glad you didn't. Glad you didn't not comment that. Without that comment, I didn't know what I would have figured out. Okay. Here's another one. Lock against spin lock mutex. Oh yeah, that's yeah. So you're writing down what it does, right? This function swaps panel, void, swap panels, panel 1, panel 2. Right? Oh, great. Great. Thank you for doing that. So what the idea is for good comments, and Armando would agree these comments aren't good, but what Osterhout says what's missing is the reason why you did it. What's the motivation? Don't write comments about what it is put in the why. You can't figure that out from the code, the why that you did that. So that should be here. And you want to put comments at a higher level so that when you change the code, which you ultimately will have to do, it doesn't break the comments, right? So so here's an example. So if we're going to be scanning an array to see if a symbol exists, do it that way rather than basically kind of implement the code in comments, right? This is a much better comment to be able to doing it. Now, what's tough about comments is there's not lots of good examples. Like open source has terrible comments. If that's your example, it's rare that you see good comments in this. When on Osterhout's code, there's as many comments as there are lines of code there that really helps it. So, so I think Armando agrees with the why part of this, that writing down why is a good thing, but he liked to believe with the elegance of Ruby that you can, and good variable names and stuff like that, the code can be understandable without the comments. But he would agree that, you know, it can't capture the why in there. And one of the big things about the legacy code is when you're trying to figure out what's going on is typically that there's no comments there that you want to try and work on that. So I don't, when I talk to my friend Osterhout, and I think he agrees with this point, what I really love about this course is virtually every time we tell you a good idea, there's a tool that implements that, a good idea. So what about ABC complexity? Well, we got flogged for that. How about cyclomatic complexity? Oh, that's Sakura, or smells. Oh, that's Reek, right? Good comments, we don't have a tool, right? The problem with that is we'd love to have some if there was a natural language understanding tool that said, hey, this is a really good comment, that'd be useful. But what I like about the course is the advice we give you, you can follow, and we can see if you follow the advice. There's tools to do that. With comments, it's, you know, somebody has to read through the code to see if you're writing good comments, and that's not as scalable, so we can't make the class as big as students would like. So let me wrap this up. So we started off with giving you advice of how to write beautiful code in SOFA. Short, do one thing, few arguments and consistent abstraction so you don't have smelly code here. And these metrics will point to areas of concern. They're not a foolproof guarantee, but they're good indicators. Big idea of behavior-driven design is these user stories and lo-fi user interfaces to be able to work with the customer right now to be able to figure out what they want, and you need to do that. How to make good ones? They need to be specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and time box. Tracker is this useful thing to be able to calculate progress. And boy, this other universe is, you know, the project manager, they get the good pay, but boy, there's a lot on the line to try and be successful. Okay, with that, we'll see you next time.